Hi, this is Dr. Georgia. I hope you find today's message a blessing in your life. We want to make sure that we continue to provide these video messages for you when you can't come to church, or for those of you who live in a different state, or we noticed recently we have a lot of people in even different countries who are tuning in. So if that is you and you can donate to us, we invite you to hit that donate button just below the message here. So thanks so much. If you will put your hand over your eyes, just open your eyes. I open my eyes to see the spiritual truth today. Now over your ears, I open my ears to hear the spiritual truth today. Now if you just put your hand over your heart and extend out your arms. I open my heart to receive the spiritual truth today. Spiritual truth that I'm working with today is that you are whole, perfect, and complete just as you are. And if we knew that, and we knew it in a deep enough level, if we had embraced that with every inch of our body, we would have awesome lives every single day. You know, I'm not talking about our ego mind getting this now. We all know egomaniacs. We call them fatheads. We call them too big for their britches. Sometimes we call them world leaders. I'm not saying we. But I'm not talking about those people. Because when we understand truly that we are whole, perfect, and complete, and we get that, we come from a very humble place.
Yes.
We come from a place that is compassionate. We come from a place that is joy-filled. We come from a place that wants everybody to succeed as much as we're succeeding. We come from a place where we want to draw the circle wider, not smaller, not smaller. We come from a very humble place when we know that we are whole, perfect, and complete. It's actually one of the reasons everybody in this church should come every single Sunday. Because every single Sunday morning, we remind you that you are whole, perfect, and complete. And in addition to the Sunday morning reminder, we also are a church that has classes and workshops and practitioners that are all designed to help us to really embrace this notion that we are whole, perfect, and complete. Well, I am working with a series that will kind of help us support that idea of our wholeness. It's a series called Mastering the Seven Decisions That Determine Personal Success in Our Life. Now, I've done the first three, and they're on YouTube, they're on CDs out here. Today, we're going to jump right into the fourth one because we're going to take the four remaining ones this morning. And the fourth decision is the decision called the Certain Decision. And what he's talking about is every time you make a decision, make it with a decided heart. A decided heart. It's that wisdom that says when we commit to something that we can see through all the way to the end, no matter what, we're going to be happier and more successful in our life. Because after we've sought the wisdom of others that we trust, not the wisdom of everybody who wants to weigh in on our decisions, but remember we talked last time about developing our own personal board of directors. Our board of directors, a kitchen cabinet that is just for us. People we trust to share our dreams with. That they're not going to make fun of them, that they're going to support us in every way. Once we've done that, then we want to know that we are the deciders. We are the deciders. See, because if we allow other people too much influence, we become wishy-washy, we become flip-floppy, and it keeps us from moving boldly in the direction of our dream. The sad fact is, there are a lot of people out there that don't feel good about themselves, who are more than willing to rain on our parade.
Yeah.
They are more than willing to tell us to stop making a decision that we have a desire to make.
Yeah.
Now, here is the thing. Often the people who are raining on our decisions, who are trying to get us to back up from the decisions that we're wanting to make, are the people who love us the most. and what they're trying to do is to keep us from being hurt. They're trying to keep us from making mistakes. Well, what we know is life's journey to our success is through a lot of mistakes. And if people are constantly trying to keep us from making those mistakes, we can't go anywhere. You remember the story from 1 Samuel of David and Goliath. And David was this scrawny little guy, young kid, who wanted to smite Goliath, the bully, big bully. And his friends, his brothers, his father, even the king himself, who needed somebody to smite Goliath or they were all going to die, tried to talk David out of it, saying that it wasn't a good decision. But David was fueled by a passion. And that's what we need to do. When we want to make a decision that we will stick to no matter what, when we want to have what is called a decided heart, we need to fuel that decision with passion. You know, David, the interesting thing about David is he was, whoever smited the Goliath was promised a lot of money, was promised a prestigious job in the kingdom, neither of which David had. But what he really wanted was the third promise, which was the beautiful daughter, the hand of the daughter. And because he had that promise, and it fueled his passion, and he wanted the daughter bad enough that he was able to continue on with a decided heart, he was victorious. And that's what we want to remember. When we have, when we can have something that has, that we have passion about in our life. In the book of James, in chapter 1, verse 8, it says this: a double-minded man is unstable all of the time. A double-minded man is unstable all of the time. If you've got all this wishy-washy thing going, it's very hard to be successful in your life. So the first decision is a decided decision. The second, the fifth decision is called the joyful decision. Deciding to be joyful in our life. Why? Because if you want to be successful, you need people around you, and you also need happy people around you. You need joy-filled people around you. You don't need the worriers and the awfulizers and the, oh, I'm going to die, I'm going to die, I'm going to die. You need the happy people around you. And in order to do that, you need to be joyful in your own heart. See, Anne Frank wrote in her diary, our lives are fashioned by the choices that are available to us out there. And then once we make that choice, the choices fashion us. The choices fashion us in our life. See, deciding to be joyful can sometimes be a trick, however, because it looks like making this choice is not always available to us. It looks like our joy, our happiness is dependent on our circumstances. What's going on around us? And the truth is that the circumstances, happy circumstances, make it easier for us to be joy-filled, but it's not the only way. We can be joy-filled in the absence of positive circumstances in our life. And the way that we need to do that is to become grateful. A grateful heart supports joy in our life. See, depression and anger may arise. It's chances are we're going to get mad sometime in our life, even though we're here in a happy, positive church and we believe in a positive theology. Chances are you're going to get mad sometime. You might even feel the blues sometime. But a grateful heart will keep you from wallowing in that depression, in that anger in your life. And everybody has something to be grateful about. If you know, if you have a choice this afternoon, what you're going to eat for lunch or brunch, or what you're going to eat for dinner tonight, if you have a choice about what you're going to eat, you're ahead of a lot of people in the world. Everybody who's in a prison this morning, everybody who's in a refugee camp today, people who are in hospitals today, they have no choice about what they're going to eat. we're ahead of the game if we have that kind of a choice. If you drove here in a car and the engine is working and it's got four tires on it, you're ahead of a lot of people in this life. You know, if you have kids and you're not worried they're thriving and you're not worried about them all the time, you're ahead of a lot of people. You have something to be grateful for in your life. See, but if you have money in your retirement account, you're ahead of a lot of people in your life. You have things to be grateful for. Did you know that over 1 million people in Mexico City are without running water? They have to have the water trucked in their neighborhoods. If you have running water, if you have a faucet at home, you're ahead of a lot of people and have something to be grateful for in this life. It's hard to be sad also when you laugh. It's hard to be sad when you laugh. Even though you don't start out being joyful, if you can find something, anything, to laugh about, you're going to be ahead of the game. You're going to be a person with a joyful spirit. Comics tell us this. Stand-up comics say, here's how you make a joke. You make a joke by looking around and seeing what's stupid about something. And he has some examples in this book. He said there's no shortage of things to find stupid in this world. On the counter of a frozen package of Mark and Spencer bread pudding, the instructions included directions on how to heat it up in the microwave, a convection oven, or a conventional oven. In large letters at the bottom it read, "Warning, this product will be hot after heating." Rowena Irons, there's a little notice on the bottom right. It says, "Do not iron your clothes on your body." 9-All has a warning, may cause drowsiness. The Sears hair dryer says, "Do not use while sleeping." And Swanson Frozen Dinner says, "Number one serving suggestion, defrost before eating." No matter how we feel, we can find things to laugh about. And when we laugh, it promotes a joyful heart in our life. The sixth decision is the compassionate decision. The compassionate decision. People who make the compassionate decision wake up every morning and say, "I will greet today with forgiveness in my heart." Yeah. I will greet today with forgiveness in my heart. Now look, we make spirituality very, very complicated. Yeah. We make it way too complicated. If you would just do that small spiritual practice every single morning when you wake up, "I greet today with forgiveness in my heart," your day will change. I promise you, it will change if you're willing to authentically make that statement when you wake up. See, the way he talks about the compassionate decision in this book, it actually would be better named the forgiveness decision. He talks a lot about anger management. He says traditional wisdom tells us the most effective anger management are anger management courses. It's part of our culture. When an athlete does something crazy, they send him to anger management classes. As an example of a book in 2006, one of the Tennessee Titans linemen stomped on the head of a Dallas Cowboy lineman because a play had been blown. And he stomped on him so badly that the guy had to have 50 stitches and 2 surgeries in order to put him back together. What did the NFL do? They benched him for 5 games. They took him out for 5 games. And then they sent him to anger management courses. Now, the same is true of celebrities. We see these celebrity court cases, and we know that people are sent to anger management classes. Fortune 500 executives send their people to anger management classes. We even have an anger management class here at CSA for court-appointed people who are mandated to take anger management in order to stay out of jail. Now, in truth, I have no problem with anger management classes. I think they're a good thing. But what he says is the wisdom of anger management courses is terribly flawed.
Yeah.
Because what we're doing is learning how to manage anger. We don't want to learn how to the techniques of managing anger. We want to dissolve the anger from the nothingness from which it came.
Yes.
And we do that by forgiveness in our life. See, there's nothing anywhere that says that you have to be asked to forgive somebody, or they have to even deserve it. Nowhere in the Bible, nowhere in any other self-help book I've ever seen on forgiveness, does it say the person has to ask for forgiveness in order for it to be effective, or never do their trespass again in order for it to be effective. Because forgiveness is never for them. It's only for us. That's what forgiveness is about. People say, well, so I just let people get away with it? Is that what I have to do? I have to forgive and forget? No. You have to forgive. You don't have to forget. But you have to forgive. See, forgiveness is about the past. Trust is about the future. So if somebody steals money from you, you need to forgive them, but you don't do business with them again. See, forgiveness is about the past, and it's only in us. Many of you have heard me tell the story. It had such an impact on me. I went to a Buddhist retreat once, and the retreat master said, over there's a table full of potatoes and a mesh bag, and I want you to take the Sharpie over there and take a potato and write down the name of every single person you need to forgive and put it in the mesh bag. And so we all did that. He said, now, you're going to take this mesh bag everywhere you go. Everywhere. You go to PTA meetings, the mesh bag goes with you. You go out on a date, the mesh bag goes with you. You go to a movie with friends, you go to the grocery store, the mesh bag, come to church, the mesh bag, everywhere you go. You go to bed, the mesh bag goes with you. You can only take a potato out when you have thoroughly forgiven somebody. Well, you know what happens to a bag with potatoes for a long period? That first the green stuff starts flying out, but then they get nasty and they get mushy. That's what's happening to our hearts. That's what's happening to our hearts. We have mushy hearts because we haven't forgiven in our life. The other thing he said about this, which I really liked, he said, forgiveness is a decision. It's not an emotion. See, when we lead with emotion, and we often think emotion is what drives our forgiveness, when we lead with emotion, our emotions will take us in a direction that is not successful for us, in a direction we don't want to go in. But when we lead with decision, our emotions will then follow us where we want to go, which is a more successful life. So the last decision is the persistent decision, All of the other decisions that we've talked about in this series rests upon this one, the persistent decision. He adds something, adds something to it. He said, without exception, make a decision to do something and do it, follow your decision without exception, no matter what's in front of you. When you persist without exception, miracles begin to occur. You can find a way where there is no way when you are persistent. But it's not easy. Almost all of you know. You've been through things that are tough to do, but you've persisted, and at the end, you are happy you did. Our beloved Rita Sago, director of our youth and family, had a stroke. She persisted. And I'm sure, I won't ask her now, but I'm sure there are days when she said, the hell with this, it's too hard. But she persisted, and she's doing so fabulously now. You know, I mentor young ministers, not young in age, but new ministers. Some are young, but most are not. New ministers who are starting new churches, because that's what I did, and so it's hard to find a mentor that's done what you've done. So I mentor, and I can't tell you how many people give up before the miracle of growth happens. It just breaks my heart that I can't keep them persistent enough. I can't light that passionate fire enough to keep them going when times are tough. And it's hard to start a new church. Most of you know I came here and I knew, did not know one soul when I came to Sacramento, not one person. And I started a church and I set 100 flyers on the passenger seat of my little Nissan pickup truck at the time. And I would not let myself go home until I handed out 100 flyers in the neighborhood around where we were starting this church, was in Midtown in Sacramento. And there were days when, you know, about the third or fourth day, and the second or third pit bull that minded was there behind that screen, you know, and I thought, I'm done. But I made myself do it. And then we had our first church service, and from those 700 flyers, because I did it for a week, from those 700 flyers, 12 people were interested enough to come and see what we were doing. And I conned 12 of my friends to drive over from Santa Rosa from my home church. But I couldn't con them back a second week. So we started with 24, we went down to, I didn't even get all the people back from Sacramento. So it came down to 8. There were 8 of us. And week after week after week, there were 8. And I thought, oh man, this is hard for 8 people. But you know what? I had passion. I had passion. And those 8 people that joined me, they caught that fire. They caught that passion. And because of that, look at what we have today. Here's the thing. This is probably the most important thing I'm going to say in all the whole series. And it just jumped out of this book at me. Anytime you hit the wall, anytime you come up with what you think is a dead end, the end of the road, what you lack is not money, it is not time, and it's not mentors. It is simply an idea.
Yeah.
When you come to the end of the road, you can't do, you're just done. Remind yourself, what I'm missing here is not money. It is not a mentor. It is not even time. It is simply an idea. So I want to end with a story that I found very inspiring. It's a story about persistence. I have a friend with whom I have had lunch. I have lunch occasionally. He's a little older than I am, but he played football as a kid too. He was better than I was, and his dream was to play professional ball. He was a quarterback all the way through high school, and he even got a scholarship to play college ball. But his dream of playing in the NFL did not look promising when he injured his back and didn't play his senior year. By the last round of the NFL draft, the anxiety and disappointment were just crushing. Finally, the phone rang. One team had made him their choice in the final round. That's after 17 rounds. He was so happy he would have signed for practically nothing, and in fact he did, $6,500 a season. Of course, making the team was going to be the toughest challenge. He was competing against 4 other quarterbacks, but he wanted this more than anything else in the world. He spent 3 weeks before his first training camp getting into shape and refining his skills. He threw thousands of balls through an old tire from an A-frame. And although his friends and family were proud of him, they didn't really expect him to make the team. In July, when he reported to camp, he was ready and scared to death. It was obvious that coaches didn't really expect him to make the team. When the jerseys were given out for the first photo session, they didn't even give him a quarterback's number. Training camp was rough. The competition was fierce, but his early preparation paid off. His confidence helped him perform well in scrimmages and preseason games, until with a final squad reduction, he was given a new jersey. Number 15, he made the team. Over the next 3 years, he sat on the bench and watched the team struggle through 3 of the most dismal years in the history of the franchise. They went through 2 coaching staffs. Morale was horrible. In his 4th year, in a bold move, the team hired a little-known assistant coach to be the head of the team. Nobody ever heard of this guy. It turned out this new coach had traveled a similar path as my friend. He had come up through the ranks. He had never been a good player, but he loved the game so much he wanted to coach. Some thought this leader was too volatile for the coaching profession. Many said he couldn't relate to the players because he was wound too tight. He was given the opportunity to coach fairly late in life, and then only because the team was so bad. My friend recalls, "If I thought it was tough to make the team, proving myself to this coach was going to be even tougher." My friend was a quiet guy, and the coach wasn't impressed with him. But he was impressed with his work habits and his stability and his confidence and his ability to persist without exception.
Yeah.
The coach saw a little of himself in my friend, not the greatest natural talent, but an innate ability to not quit. In my friend's fourth year, the starting quarterback went down with an injury. My friend was ready. Now remember, he sat there for 3 years on that bench. This was what he had worked so hard for. He went into the game and brought the team back from behind. After that game, Bart Starr became the starting quarterback for the Green Bay Packers. And Vince Lombardi, the little-known coach, went on to coach forever. Persistence is not easy, and it's not something you do alone. Persistence is a team sport. So you gather people around from this community. When you're out of ideas and you just don't know where to go, call a practitioner and say, "I want to persist in this dream, but I'm really contemplating giving up." Don't make this your only your Sunday exposure to this church. Practitioners, please stand in the church. Yeah. Their pictures are out there. Their business cards are out there. Don't hesitate to call them and say, "I'm stuck. Help me." Let's take this message into prayer, knowing that there's only one power. It's the power of God. It's the power of God that flowed through Dr. Ken Gordon with that beautiful press release for our transgender sisters and brothers. It's that one presence of God that is working so hard to keep immigrants safe in this country. It's that one presence that is working for solutions on both sides of the aisle right now, bringing people together in discussions. I see it. I feel it. I know that solution is here. Nonviolent, gentle solution is here. I give thanks for that. I release this word into the law, and together we say, and so it is.